Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello, everyone. Well, I hope this Friday night finds everyone well and healthy out there. I've got two stories lined up for you tonight, and we're going to keep it short and sweet, so grab your snacks and let's get started. I live in Cambridge, Ohio, a small town surrounded by trees and borders the Salt Fork State Park, although what happened to me was right in the middle of town. Me and a buddy named Zach decided to go early morning carp fishing at the creek by my mom's house. It was, I think, February. I had a good spot at the bike path a couple streets over, so we packed up and went down. We got there and got all rigged up and cast it out. To kill the time until we got a fish, I put my phone on the bucket we had and turned on Netflix and started to look for something to watch. We heard a big splash come from the other side of the creek. On the other side of this creek is a big patch of woods that runs right through the middle of town. Any animal can just pass through town in those woods without being bothered by people. It starts at Tunnel Hill and lets out behind the sheriff's station. But we heard a big splash come from the other side of the creek bank, so I shined my spotlight in that area and there was a big chunk of broken ice in the shallow water with ripples around it. Something made that ice fall, or it was thrown. But we just shrugged it off and kept trying to decide on a good movie. Then we hear splash, splash, splash. I got my light up just in time to see a chunk of ice hit the water, and it was the size of my chest. That moment, I felt uncomfortable. So we started packing up and shining the light across the creek every couple minutes. Then right before we left, a chunk of ice that had to be 40 or 50 pounds or more landed on our side of the creek in the shallow water. So we ran out of there. I fish a lot in this area, and it's always felt like something in those woods across the creek was watching me. But I always assumed it was a homeless man or some deer. I still fish there all the time, and next time, I'm not running. I will be there with my spotlight and try to see what it is. I listen to you at work. I work 12-hour shifts, and it makes my day go by faster. Thank you, Christian. In 2004, a friend I worked with said that I could hunt on the acreage he had over in Ohio. I don't want to say exactly where it is, because it isn't my land, and even though I told him all that happened, he doesn't believe me. So I'll just say that it was over in Ohio, but I live over in Pennsylvania. The first time out there, he was there with me, of course, to show me where all the boundaries were. I would never have found the way onto his land if he hadn't been there. To turn in from the road, you're just looking for some tire rut impressions in the dirt. The path on the way back isn't clear. The whole way, you're smacking down small brush and stuff is scraping the sides of your truck. The tire ruts totally disappear about 150 yards away from the road. From there, it was just by navigation through the trees. We came to a spot that was big enough to just pull up side by side. From there on, the brush was thicker, and the path was just wide enough to walk on. You couldn't take a car any further. But that time, nothing happened. But when I went out there alone sometime later to scout for where I wanted to set up and see game movement, well, that was something different. I had seen plenty of sign that day and had been watching movements all day long, and I had decided already where I wanted to set up for the next day. I had planned to possibly stay a few days, so I had everything in my truck that I would need. After an unrelated incident when I was a teenager, I don't feel safe sleeping in a tent, so I always sleep in the bed of my truck, which has a cap on it. When I was trying to sleep that night, I kept hearing calls out there, and I didn't know what they were. I was trying to figure out what they were, and honestly, I was trying to figure out if it was something that maybe I would want to hunt and eat. But I didn't know what they were. I'd never heard them before. I have since listened to all kinds of sounds on the internet that they say is a Bigfoot. but I have yet to find anything close to the sounds that I heard. What I heard was a yelling sound that wavered up and down the scales. I knew whatever it was had a very big set of lungs. What I heard was loud and very full-sounding, not at all like a high shrill or a shriek from a small animal or a bird. Finally, I started to fall asleep, but I wasn't too far gone when I felt the truck moving a little, like something had bumped up against it. Now, I had slept in my truck many times over the years, but nothing had ever come up and bumped the truck. Even the bears that came around did not touch my truck, so I was surprised for sure. I didn't move so I could just listen. I heard something walking. Then I heard more than one, and I figured out it wasn't four paws or four hooves that I was hearing on the dirt. I was thinking of what it might be when I felt the truck get bumped again, this time a little harder. I rolled over and leaned up on my elbow to look out the long window on the cab side of the truck. But they are tinted, which means you see even less of anything in the darkness. It was archery season, so I did not have my rifle with me, but I did have a 9mm within reach. I have a concealed carry, and I keep it with me for personal protection. I had a cell phone, but there was no reception out there, at least not back then, so there was no chance of calling anybody. I thought maybe it was some teenagers or some people out there, and maybe they thought the truck was unoccupied or that I shouldn't be there, and maybe they just wanted to scare me off. So I called out, telling them I was allowed to be there, that I was in there, and that I was armed. It went silent for a second. Then suddenly I felt all kinds of hits on my truck and bumps and slaps. And they were coming from all different parts of my truck. So now I knew there was more than one. I called out over and over to stop it. But I swear I think it just made whatever it was madder, and the rocking and thumping got worse. In those minutes, I was figuring out all kinds of things all at once, so I can't explain every little thing I was thinking. But I did know that the truck was not being hit with anything like a baseball or a stone or anything like that. It didn't have that kind of sound. Now, this lasted maybe 2 or 3 seconds. I was almost convinced that it was just some stupid humans out there playing stupid games, not knowing that they could win a really stupid prize from me and my 9mm by accident. I really just thought human for sure when I heard footsteps, now a single pair, clearly on 2 feet, walking along the side of the truck, almost to where I was, and then they stopped. I just wanted whoever it was to move on, and I knew that humans would leave if they knew I was armed. And animals usually scatter when they hear humans. So I yelled out again that I was armed and I was getting tired of this game. I listened for a second, and there was nothing. No movement. But then I could hear breathing just on the other side of the cap. It sounded like a breathy, hollow, nasal sound. I don't mean it was heavy breathing like an animal that had just stopped running, but it was an even breathing sound, but deep. Then I thought again about the calls I had heard earlier and wondered if this was what made those calls. And I had to think again about the set of lungs and how big they had to be to make those calls I had heard. I had dug around in my bag till I found my light. It's a mag LED. I stretched out my left arm, then pushed the light up against the tinted glass, trying to look outside without being blinded by any shine back I might get from the glass. But the thing with window tint is that it is designed to stop light. The mag LED did throw a weak light outside the cap, but not much once it got outside the glass and spread around out there. It lightened things, but nothing was spotlighted like it would be without tint on the window. If you have tint on a car window, go out and try it one night. Try to look in your car and try to look outside the car with a flashlight. You'll see what I mean. Some lights won't shine at all through tent. But I could make out the brush out there, and then suddenly I couldn't see the brush. Something had walked in front of where the flashlight was at the window where I could see, and it walked right in front of it. Same time, my truck rocked just a little again from being bumped. Also at the same time, it began to register to me that when I no longer saw the brush out there, what I saw was something furry that had blocked my view for that second. I'm not afraid to say I was scared. I clicked off my flashlight and quickly sat back with my back up against the cab window of the truck. If I could have, I would have crawled through to the cab of the truck, and I would have gotten out of there. But I was trapped for the time being in the bed of the truck, with just me and a truck cap between whatever's out there and my safety. Yeah, I was thinking about what could be furry and tall enough to block my view out the side window of my truck cap and strong enough to rock my truck. Yeah, Bigfoot did come to mind, but I didn't know then that there were supposedly anywhere at all but the Pacific Northwest and maybe Canada. I didn't know much about them. So I kept telling myself that that wasn't it. It had to be something like a bear that walked upright just at that moment that the light caught it. And then I thought, man, that is one big bear. No way I was going out there. And I wished hard for my rifle at that moment. Whatever it was, I knew a 9mm was no protection, never mind the logistics of me trying to use a compound bow in the back of a truck. Now, I know someone's out there like, dude, you should have done this. You should have done that. I would have done this. And all I have to say to you Monday morning quarterbackers is, golf, foxtrot, Yankee. Got it? I pushed the backlight on my watch to see the time. It was 11:12 p.m. God help me, that meant I had a very long wait to daylight, and that was my only thought. I seriously once again considered trying to break through to the truck cab and trying to drive out of there, but I figured that really wasn't a smart move in the darkness. Even with the truck headlights, I wasn't sure I could pick my way out correctly. I also considered that if the truck started moving and they got pissed off more, whatever it was, well, I would have no chance of getting speed up and losing them out there in that brush, and I had to hope I didn't hit something that stopped me in the darkness, like a tree stump or a tree. At those moments, I was thinking through all kinds of things, but I decided that staying put in a defensive position just seemed best. Yeah, I was in the truck to sleep, but I had left other things outside, so there was room for me and my small inflatable mattress inside the truck. No food was left out, of course, but there was a folding sling chair, my cooking grate, and stuff like that. I would find out in the morning that they were out there tossing my stuff around. By 4 a.m., it had been quiet now for over an hour. The noises hadn't been constant all night, but every so often I would hear something. Just when I thought maybe they had gone away, then they would make another noise or bump the truck again. Now by 5 a.m., it was 2 hours since I had heard anything, and I thought maybe I could safely get out of the cab and into the front of the truck, but I just couldn't make myself move. It was close to 7 a.m. before I thought it was light enough and I felt okay to get out. I checked all the views from the back of the truck that I could get to and see out of. I didn't see anything. I checked again and again. And this is when I saw that all my stuff had been slung around and scattered. When I did get out, I didn't stop to pick up any of my stuff. I got into the truck cab as fast as I could, and I started trying to pick my way through back out of there. Once I got the truck started and started trying to look around for the tracks where I'd come in, I suddenly had a moment of panic. They had trampled so much out there that I almost couldn't find where I was supposed to go at first. I was completely disoriented. I know that sounds stupid because I knew where my truck was in relation to the road and where I came in the day before. But truthfully, the sleepless night had scrambled my brain. And when I started to move the truck, then tree branches and rocks were hitting my truck. And not because of where I was driving. They were being thrown. I looked over to the left, and I saw that one of them was quickly closing the distance to my truck. He would have won the Miss Ugly Ohio pageant for sure. I'd put his height at 7.5 feet. Black fur, but not long fur. Don't know about the face. It wasn't so close to me. Maybe 25 or 30 yards away. I could clearly see it, and could clearly see it was moving toward me, but not a face. Had a big old football head, too. Freaky long arms, and I remember those. They were swinging high as he started to pick up speed coming toward me. I just had that glance. No more. I then put my eyes straight to the front, hit the gas, and kept my eyes forward, picking out the way out of there. When I made it out to the road, I burst out of there, and if there had been anyone out there on the road, I would have hit them. Good thing nobody was on the road at that time of the morning. By the time I hit the Pennsylvania border, I was calmed down. The miracle is that I didn't pass a single cop that morning, because if I had, he'd have pulled me over for sure. I was speeding so bad. Once home, I didn't tell anyone what had happened at first. A few days later, though, my friend asked me how it went. I couldn't bring myself to tell him, so I lied and I told him I didn't get anything and I had just felt unwell and come home early. About a week or so after that, though, I got an angry call from him. You see, his brother had just been out there to do some hunting himself, and he had told him that I had left the place littered with stuff. So I got chewed out by the guy for leaving the place a mess, and I was told I wouldn't be welcome to hunt there anymore. Not that I wanted to, but it still stung. So that's when I told him all about that night and what really happened. Of course, that was a mistake, and I just made it worse. My mistake was not in telling him or anyone what happened right away. My advice, if you see one of those things, don't keep it to yourself. You need to tell someone. Yeah, they might laugh at you, sure, and they might not. But that way, no one's going to accuse you of using it as an excuse. And if you tell someone right then, right after it happens, they will know whether or not you've been drinking or whatever. If I could have a do-over, I'd be telling everybody right away. But I didn't. But that guy, that supposed friend of mine, told everyone we worked with about it. And from then on, well, you know, I was the big joke around there. I was the crazy guy who saw Bigfoot. So call me that, Nance. Call me the crazy guy who saw Bigfoot. I don't mind it so much anymore. Wow, everyone. Well, I hope you enjoyed those encounters. Me, I loved them. I love all the encounters I get. I'm still working on putting a lot of the smaller ones together. And, you know, I have a lot of encounters that they say they didn't see a Bigfoot, but they're pretty certain they heard one or they smelled one. What do you guys think about putting all of those together in one video? Would you want to hear those? I still find them interesting. And, you know, I really think it might be more common to hear a Bigfoot than it is to see one. I really do. And judging by the amount of emails I get from each type of encounter, I think it is more common. And I think a lot of those times that people do hear something, they may not know it's a Bigfoot. I think they pass those sounds off as something else. Well, anyway, that's something to think about, isn't it? All right. Well, everyone, that's it for tonight. We'll be meeting up again real soon. And I have a really good feeling that we will. I don't think I need to sign off with who I am. You guys know that already. And I sure know who you guys are. But I can't leave without reminding you all that absence of proof is not proof of absence. Take care, everyone, and thank you for listening. If you like what you've heard and want to hear more, hit the like and subscribe button, and don't forget the bell to get notification. Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? If so, drop me a line at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com and tell me all about it. Then I'll share it with everyone.